Dear participants, welcome to the second day, first lecture of our flipped and blended classroom FDP. Again, today we have with us our distinguished professor, Dr. Sunil Dutt, with us. Today he is actually explaining a very important concept of blended learning, that is implementation of a flipped classroom. And all of you know, many of you just are aware of what is a very vague definition of flipped classroom. But if you want to really implement it as a part of your teaching learning process, you need to understand the concepts, the modalities and other issues very clearly. So definitely today's lecture will help all of you to implement this flipped classroom concepts as a part of your teaching learning process. It is a very interesting session, and definitely this theory should be very well, because many of us know different tools. Just understanding the tools is actually of no use. People have to understand the clear concept and the theory behind such kind of implementations. So now I request Professor Sunil Dutt, sir, to take over the session.
So thank you, Professor Srinivasaji, and good morning to all the participating teachers from all over the country. So friends, as informed you by Dr. K.G. Srinivasa, this session is about flipped classroom, which is a new method of teaching that is turning the traditional classroom on its head. So friends, you see, every day, thousands of teachers deliver the exact same lesson in class to millions of students. And every evening or night, millions of students sit over the exact same homework, trying to figure out how to solve it. And as teachers, we have been facing number of difficulties while delivering a lecture in the classroom or while marking the homework of the students. So now you can take 1 minute and identify a frustration you have in your teaching or with your students' learning. Okay, so take 1 minute and identify frustrations or difficulties or problems you have been facing while delivering lecture in the classroom or while conducting practical or while say checking the assignments or homework of the students. Yes, and on a sheet of paper, now finish this sentence. If I could fix one thing in my classes, it would be. That is, say, if you could be able to solve some of the problems in the classroom, you can make your teaching learning very meaningful, and the students will get or will be able to learn or may be able to understand the concepts very well. So say you have got a list of difficulties or frustrations you have noticed in your teaching or with your students' learning. So you can broadly classify those frustrations or need in 4 categories of common findings. One is related with student motivation, because all of us talk among themselves, what can we do to motivate students to learn? Because students are not attentive, students find classroom lecture very much boring, or students are not able to grasp the meaning of the material. Why? Because the teacher is not relating the content with examples, or he is not giving some of the illustrations, or he is not monitoring the progress during lecture. That is, he's not asking question, or he's not allowing the student to respond, or he's not providing feedback. Another is unique instructional capabilities, support for new instructional approaches, increased teacher productivity. So let us have a look at these. Student motivation. You see, as a teacher, everybody needs to capture the interest of his or her students. The teacher wants students to have a greater sense of control over their learning, or as a teacher, I think that my students are not prepared for class discussion because they haven't kept up with the textbook reading, because they are not able to provide individualized instruction in the classroom. So that is why they are not able to grasp the meaning of the material. So they find classroom lecture very much uninteresting or boring, because the teacher is on many occasion following only one way of communication. That is, he is simply talking at the student, where students sit as passive listeners. Okay, students are not engaged. So I told you yesterday that when you enter the classroom, various students have different expectation. One student says, "Sir, if you tell me means that is teaching by telling only." He says, "I will forget," isn't it? So because you are simply pouring the information into the minds of the students, they are not involved. Second is, "Sir, if you show us," means you have brought some PPT or you are performing some experiment in the classroom, you are writing main points on the board. Okay, the student says, "If you show me, I may remember." And the third expectation is, "Sir, if you involve me, okay, I will be always with you." So you have to develop your lecture by involving the students' participation, and this is not possible in the traditional classroom teaching. The second one is the unique instructional capabilities, because I need that I should be able to demonstrate processes. Because of one reason or the other reason, I am not able to demonstrate. My students need access to extra resources to update or expand on what the text offers, and this is not possible in a normal, you can say, conventional mode of teaching. Or I would like students to track their progress in the course. So I'm not giving them practice task question, or you can say where they can evaluate themselves. My students need to be able to assess their understanding of the content. Or I would like to provide students with more immediate feedback of their work. This is not possible again in a normal classroom teaching, because in the classroom, teacher asks one question or two question to one or two students, and rest of the students are not given any kind of question, or they are not given any kind of feedback. So, and secondly, the teacher gives homework and students submit the homework, but teacher returns them after say 15 days or 20 days, the assignments are returned to them, and with no conscientious, you can say, remarks. Simply the teacher writes checked, noted, okay, or needs improvement, so no gaps are highlighted. Another is that my students need to spend more time on task practicing a skill, which is not possible in a normal classroom teaching, because the teacher is simply delivering the lecture because he has to complete the syllabus. Another is support for new instructional approaches. I would like to reduce the amount of time spent in class on lecturing without sacrificing coverage of the content. And this is not possible by following traditional, but this is possible if you follow some new instructional approach on which we are going to deliver, on which we are going to learn about it. My students need opportunities for continuing discussion for peer learning. This is possible only if the learning material is provided to them and they need to study at home, and in the classroom they will get enough opportunities for discussion. I would like to help my students focus more on understanding and application rather than will this be on the test. Okay, so this is possible only because when they are involved or engaged in problem solving activity in the classroom, so they will be more focused towards understanding and application. I would like to give my students a greater sense of responsibility for their learning. This is possible if you allow them number of opportunities in the classroom. Increased teacher productivity. I would like to do more activity based learning in class, but you see, I have a lot of material I need to cover. So because the content matter is too much, and he's simply dictating the content or reading out from his or her notes. I would like students to have more frequent grade updates. Okay, so in what category would you put your need? Obviously, the application is that the faculty needs to be encouraged to move from a teaching model where the teacher is dominating, that is from a teacher-centered model to a learner-centered model where students are engaged. They are responsible for their own learning. Now the question is, how do you do that in your class? So how do you, as a faculty member at an institute that emphasizes teaching, move from the sage on the stage to the guide on the side? You see, sage on the stage means when the students are immature, or you can say students do not possess prerequisites and the teacher is dominating. Now you have to shift to guide on the side. That is, you need to provide supplementary information only. The rest of the material they can study outside the classroom. So how do we reach this new generation of learners? Why? Because you see, we are living in a time when things are moving very fast. The rules of the game are changing. Science is changing. Technology is changing. The world of work has changed. But our students are, you see, for the most part, still constrained by traditional transmission models of, you see, learning. So you see, today's students grew up with internet access, YouTube, Facebook, MySpace, and a host of other, you see, digital resources. And they can typically be found doing their homework while texting their friends, while emailing on Facebook and listening to music all at the same time. So the next generation students are, you see, highly technology oriented. They are highly devised. They use technology like Facebook, Flickr, as I've told you, to be constantly connected to friends, family, information, and entertainment. And technology, you see, allows them to connect with more people in more ways and more often. So highly devised, they are highly networked, they are highly interactive because they don't want to sit quiet. So they want to interact with their friends. So they want, there should be a two-way communication in the classroom, not only with the teacher, but with other students in the classroom. And they are highly social. So that is why teachers need a socio-digital, I would say, pedagogy that demands the application to online, hybrid, and face-to-face learning environment. So in one of the studies, we have found that the survey was taken on a sample of 8 to 18 years old kids, and it was found that the kids spend about 6 hours 21 minutes with media per day, one media or the other media. 26% of the time they use more than two media simultaneously. They spend about 3 hours 51 minutes on TV or video, watching video per day, and they spend 1 hour 44 minutes on music per day, 1 hour 2 minutes using computer other than for school, college work, 49 minutes playing video games, 43 minutes of recreational reading. So friends, the students, to them, the computers are not the technology. Okay, so throwing a computer into a classroom does not make the learning effective. It means teachers need to understand how to use technology effectively, understand the learning theories behind the practice, and know how to select the right technology for the learning outcomes they seek. So the students are multitasking, and for them, reality is more and more a meaningless term. Now, what we know about, you see, successful learning. Now, successful learning is one in which the students remain active. They need to proceed at their own pace, and they need to be provided with immediate knowledge of result. So when the students remain active in the classroom, they would be more attentive, they would listen to the teacher, they will respond to the teacher, they will, you see, they will learn by doing something, they will learn by interacting with their peers, with their teacher. Contextual. That is, you need to, you see, relate the theoretical concept with examples from their daily life. So the learning material which you are going to provide to the students for study at home must relate the content with examples from the daily life, or from the examples from the, you see, word of work, or with the use of number of illustrations, or by using technology. And the successful learning is one where the students are engaged. So engagement of student is another very important requirement of a successful learning, and interactive. So this is another, you see, and they need to be social. So for successful learning, all these five components are very much essential. And if you look at the learning pyramid, you see, we tend to understand only 10% of what we read, 20% of what we hear, and 30% of what we see. Now come to when both the senses are involved. So 50% of what we both hear and see, and then 70% of what we speak. Okay. When the teacher provides some opportunity to interact with the students, and 90% of what we both say and do. Okay. So this is wonderful. You see, this this pyramid is given here. At the top is the reading only, and at the base is doing the real thing. So doing the real thing makes learning more effective and more meaningful. So many a times in smaller classroom, although the teacher says, please read this para from this page to this page. Okay, so they are simply reading, but when they are reading, they find certain, you can say, doubts, but the teacher is not allowing for the further clarification.
Sir, वो headache हो रहा है sir.
किसको headache हो रहा है? Okay. Now.
No, sir, ये MLT में अगर बंद होता है तो शायद staff room के पीछे लगा हुआ है sir. Staff room में ही है.
So to address these needs, we try to open up class time.
नहीं sir, नहीं sir, staff room है जहाँ दीपिका मैडम और ये पूजा मैम बैठती हैं. जी जी सर.
So hello, please don't speak now. Okay. So to address these needs, we try to open up class time for active learning strategies. So, but how do I do that and still provide the same coverage of the content is very, you can say, important. And this is where we need the classroom flip model. So the classroom flip model is turning the problem of traditional classroom teaching upside down. You see, traditionally students listen to lectures and take tests in class, read textbooks and work on problems at home. But in flipped teaching, students first study the topic by themselves with the use of video lessons on YouTube, which the teacher has provided the link, and then apply the knowledge by solving problems and doing practical work in the classroom. Okay, so modern institute, many modern, I know many institutions, modern institutions who flipped their classroom, they have reported number of benefits, and according to them, flipping allows all the students to learn at their own pace, as the video can be viewed by them again and again, or the e-content they can read again and again. And flipping is more efficient, as you see, students enter the classroom with preparation to contribute and flipping enriches the lesson as more time can be spent on group work and projects. And friends, doing homework in class, in traditional mode, we are doing homework at home. So in the flip model, we are doing homework in class. So that will allow students to help each other. So which benefits both the advanced as well as less average, or you can say below average students. So a flipped classroom, you see, is a new instructional strategy. And I would also say it is a type of blended learning, which is focused on student engagement and active learning, giving the teacher a better opportunity to deal with mixed levels or student difficulties and differentiated learning preferences during in-class time. So the flipped classroom has been highlighted as an emerging technology, and it is known as a student-centered approach to learning, where the students are more active than the teacher in the classroom activity. So in this case, the teacher will act as a facilitator to motivate, to guide, and to give feedback on student performance. So flipping means, you see, what is typically presented in the class, we are presenting lectures, content, background, knowledge, or real life experiences in the class by the teacher, and students receive at home via a reading material. So that reading material, which is going to be presented by the teacher, it will be given to the students in advance. So they get the reading material, self-learning material, computer-assisted instruction, YouTube video, and other online resources. They study at home, and actual problem solving is carried out in the classroom. So what is typically given as homework is done in class with the assistance of teacher in the flipped model. So a flipped classroom is one that flips or inverts the typical cycle of content acquisition and application. You see, content application, content acquisition is carried out in normal classroom teaching in the class, and its application is carried out in the home when the teacher gives them homework. Now in the flipped model, this cycle is now inverted. Now students acquire knowledge, or you can say skill, by going through e-content, self-learning material, computer-assisted instruction material, video, etc. before class. And the application part is carried out in the class, because the teacher guides students to actively and interactively clarify and apply that knowledge during the class. So the teacher has to develop e-content, maybe in the form of, I would say better, it should be in the form of self-learning material, because self-learning material, it can be in the form of a print material, or it can be in the form of computer assisted instruction. So self-learning material is a method of providing individualized instruction in which the learner is active and proceeds at his or her own pace and is provided with immediate knowledge of result. So self-learning material is usually written on the conversational mode. That is, when a student reads the material, he feels that a teacher is talking to him and not simply he is reading out the text from the material. So self-learning material presents the content matter in small chunks. Language is interactive, lot of illustrations are included. There is a self-practice task, then self-feedback is available. Then he moves to the second unit. Again, it is followed by practice task and feedback. And if it is through CAI, gaining, that is computer assisted instruction material, then we can include animations. We can also append videos and necessary illustrations. So that material is studied by the student at the home, and in the classroom, teacher guide the students to actively and interactively clarify and apply that knowledge during class. So a flipped classroom, friends, intentionally shifts instruction to a learner-centered model in which time in the classroom is used to explore topics in greater depth and create meaningful learning opportunities, while students are initially introduced to new topics outside of the classroom. Maybe they study at home. So content delivery at home may take variety of forms like video lessons, but I recommendation is that each video should not be more than 15 minutes. It should range from 8 to 12 minutes, because otherwise the student will find the video very boring. So video lessons prepared by the teacher or even third parties for delivering content. I'm saying third party because many videos have been developed by other teachers. These are also available on YouTube. You can identify the video and provide the web links to the students. Online collaborative discussions, digital research, and text readings. So now different experts have given different definitions to flipped model. So it is that which is traditionally done in class is now done at home, and that which is traditionally done as homework is now completed in class. So it's a simple definition. So something which is traditionally done in the class, now in the flipped model, it will be done at home. And that which is traditionally done as homework is now completed in the classroom. Okay. So flipping the classroom involves pushing lecture material outside the classroom as a form of homework or other pre-class preparation, leaving more time in class for interactive or engaging the exercises. Another definition given by Abhyasikara and Dawson, they say it is nothing but set of pedagogical approaches that move most information transmission teaching out of class, because in routine traditional classroom method, we pour the information into the minds of the students and then we give them list of exercises to carry out at home. Now in this case, the teacher will use class time for learning activities that are active and social, means the students are totally engaged. They carry out the task in small groups and require students to complete pre-test and post-class activities to fully benefit from in-class work. Now, I'll give you now the comparative analysis before the flip and after the flip. Now, before the flip, students are assigned something to read and students try to follow along. Whereas in the flipped model, students are guided through learning module that asks and collects questions. That is why I told you that learning material in the form of self-learning or computer instruction material is provided to the student before class. So they study those modules. Those modules have inbuilt practice task questions followed by feedback. So student practice performing the skills they are expected to learn. Now during the classroom, now before the flip, the teacher provides the information, he delivers the lecture, and students attempt the homework usually with delayed feedback. So yes, you see they are given homework and they get the delayed feedback. Whereas in the flipped model, teacher guides the process with feedback and supplementing information. You see, in case the students have got some doubt, they need some clarification because they have studied the material at home. So when they come to the classroom, they have some queries. So in order to clarify those queries, the teacher provides mini lecture or teacher provides supplementary information to clarify those doubts. And students continue applying their knowledge skills after clarification and feedback. नो आफ्टर द क्लास बिफोर द फ्लिप टीचर ग्रेड्स द पास्ट वर्क दैट इज द होमवर्क ओके नाउ इन दिस केस टीचर पोस्ट एनी एडिशनल एक्सप्लेनेशन एंड रिसोर्सेज एज नेसेसरी एंड ग्रेड्स हायर क्वालिटी वर्क नाउ देयर इज ऑफिस आवर बिकॉज एज अ टीचर वी टेक टू और थ्री क्लासेस एवरी डे एंड वी आर सपोज टू बी इन द इंस्टीट्यूट फॉर अबाउट another 2 to 3 hours to provide guidance in case some students need the guidance of the teacher. So the teacher has to be available. So students want confirmation about what to study. They go to teacher. Teacher often repeats what was in lecture. So this is during office hours before the flip. Now after the flip, students are equipped to seek help where they know they need it. And teacher continues guiding students towards deeper understanding. So flipped teaching or flipped classroom, as I told you in the beginning, is a form of blended learning in which students learn new content. I'm specifying again and again to make the concept clear that the students learn new content through reading material, usually at home. Reading material or self-learning material, computer system material, or online by watching video lectures if you have provided them certain links, usually at home. And what used to be homework is now done in class with teacher offering more personalized guidance and interaction with students instead of lecturing. And it is also known as backward classroom. Or reverse instruction, or flipping the classroom, or reverse teaching. After this process is over, I'll give you some. You can say I'll give you a sample of computer-assisted instruction. What are its characteristics, and how you can develop computer-assisted instruction very easily. So traditional method of teaching. The students are assigned to read textbooks and work on problems set outside the institute while listening to lectures and taking tests. In flipped teaching, the students first study the topic by themselves, typically using video lessons. Now, coming to Bloom's taxonomy. Before coming to the classroom, students have got the e-content video linkage. So they study at home and they try to remember some of the things or they try to grasp the meaning of the material. Okay, so that part is generally done in the traditional teaching and application analysis evaluation is carried out at home in the traditional model. And in the flipped model, the students try to remember and grasp the material at home. When they come to the classroom, they apply whatever they have learned in the classroom in a similar other situation, of course, under the guidance of their teacher, and they try to analyze something into its constituent part. They look for various relationships. And again, another assignment is given for transfer of learning, for evaluating and for creating. So maybe small groups can be formed where they can evaluate whatever they have learned. They can create something new. They can design something new, etc. So friends, flipped classroom is not just online video. It is not just online video that you have given to them and they have studied and now your role is nowhere. No. It is not just reading or learning material. It is not about replacing teachers with videos, reading material or learning material. It is not an online class. It is not where the students work without structure. It is not where students work in isolation. It is not where students spend the entire class online. Okay, flipped classroom is a means to have more contact time with the teacher. Okay, so students have more contact time with the teacher, because in a traditional model, teacher is simply delivering the lecture. So it is mainly teacher centered and students are not engaged. So by flipping, we can increase the student contact time with the teacher. It is an environment that increases student responsibility. So students own the responsibility of their own learning. It is blended type of instruction, where some direct instruction and constructivist learning is provided. It is a class where all students are engaged, a class where absent students won't fall behind. You see, in a normal classroom teaching, you are teaching to the students. And if a student is absent, he will not get the material. But in this model, all the students are provided with material. In case one or two students fail to come to the classroom because of one reason or the other, they will not fall behind. Okay. It is a class where all students are engaged in their learning. So there is a shift from traditional teaching to blended instruction. Now let us have a look at the advantages of flipped classroom over traditional method of teaching and learning. To sum up, you see, the flipped model teaches students to take responsibility for their own learning. So with this model, the onus for learning is placed squarely on the students, and in order to succeed, the students must take responsibility for their own learning. As the teacher, you see, gives up the control of the learning process, so student takes the rein and education process becomes their own. It creates a way to easily personalize and differentiate the classroom. So flipped mastery allows the direct instruction to be asynchronous, so differentiation for each student becomes possible. The pace of the class is appropriate for each student, and definitely this personalizes the learning for each student. It makes learning the center of the classroom. You see, flipped classroom has become laboratory of learning, where you see the entire focus is on what students have or have not learned. So what we provide them all tools and materials to learn, and we support them by helping them develop a plan for how and when they will learn. Another is, it gives students instant feedback and reduces teacher paperwork. You see, in the traditional classroom teaching, the teacher provides homework to be carried out at home, and hardly the teacher provides any feedback. But in this case, the homework is carried out in the classroom and teacher provides immediate, informative, constructive feedback, and that also reduces teacher's paperwork. This provides opportunities for, you see, remediation. So flip model, you see, in the tell you about the traditional model. You see, in the traditional model, the class moves on with or without students who do not understand, and the pace of the class is set by the teacher, and it is based on the material that is to be delivered on that particular day. And under this model, and under the traditional model, if some students get further behind, their grade suffers and they are penalized. But in case of flipped model, the slower students are not penalized. Instead, we give them ample opportunities to relearn and remediate. Okay, so remedial instruction is provided to the student. It allows for multiple means of learning the content. So, say through videos, assignment, laboratory, or references, textbooks. So, number of material is given and provides multiple chances for demonstrating understanding through verbal discussion, detailed PowerPoint presentation, short videos, demonstration of understanding, or other methods developed by the teacher as well as the student. It changes the role of the teacher. So instead of standing in front of the room, simply pouring the information and being the center of the attention, now in this case, teachers spend the time doing what is important. What is important is helping students, leading small groups, and working with individuals who are struggling. And it ensures that all students are involved. So in a flipped mastery class, all students are in charge of their own learning. Another is the mastery learning makes hands-on activities more personal. So hands-on activities, you see, help students learn in a way other than direct instruction. So in the traditional classroom teaching, we would conduct these hands-on activities in a large group, and the whole class would receive instruction on the experiment, and all the students would conduct the activities simultaneously. Because the flipped model is asynchronous, so students conduct the experiments when they are ready to do so. So the time may vary from student to student. So to conclude, the benefits of a flipped classroom to students: students learn at their own varying speed. They are provided opportunities for review. Materials are ready and prepared for the absentee students also. Students take ownership of their learning. They are actively involved with their peer, and they do not struggle with completing homework. And benefits to teacher are that the focus is on being guide on the side and not the sage on the stage. That is, guide on the side means learner centered, where teacher is simply supplementing the information, or he is facilitating the students to learn. Sage on the stage means that he knows everything and he is simply pouring the information. That is a simple lecture method. So in this case, teachers spend more time for supplementing. Teachers spend less time managing student classroom behavior. They collaborate with peers. The teachers collaborate with peers in developing the material. So material can be developed with a group of 2-3 teachers, and the teacher is involved with learning rather than lecturing. It means the teacher is also learning along with the students in the classroom. So friends, the role of the teacher has now changed in the context of flipped classroom. So in order to function, you see, as an effective teacher in the flipped mastery environment, very important characteristics are expected of him. Firstly, the teacher should be a content master. So a teacher who is not proficient in his content area cannot operate in a flipped mastery class. So the ability to mentally move from one topic to another is very important on the part of the teacher, and a comprehensive understanding of the interconnectedness of the content is essential. Because in a normal classroom teacher is simply reading out the text from his notes, but in this case that part is done by the students at home. So actual problem solving, it means the teacher has to be proficient in his subject area. That very important characteristics. The teacher must be able to admit when he or she doesn't know the answer to student question, and must be willing to research an answer with the student. Say, the student has asked some question and teacher has no answer, see, so honestly he should admit that right now I don't know its answer, so I will study at home, you study at home, so tomorrow we will discuss this answer. Maybe another technique, you can redirect that question to other students. If you have got any answer, so by the time the student respond to your, this question, you will get some time to recollect the original. In case you have no answer, then honestly admit it, and next time when you enter the classroom, you need to discuss that question. But this should not happen every day. So otherwise, you will lose the interest and confidence of your students. Okay. Another is, the teacher must be able to flow through a class period in a non-linear fashion. You see, all the students are at different places in their mastery and understanding of the learning outcome. So it is the role of the teacher to meet each student where he or she is. Okay. The teacher must be able to give up control of the learning process to the students. Another is that teacher has to play the role of a supportive coach. Now in this model, teacher is here to encourage the students along the road of learning. Students need a coach who can come alongside them and guide them in discovery of knowledge. So to conclude, flipped classroom method has helped teachers doing what is more important, that is helping students, leading small groups, working with individuals who are struggling, and so on. Now friends, the literature is available. Various research scholars or educationists have carried out number of studies about the effect of flipped classroom on achievement of students in different subjects. And many of studies, I would say 90% of the studies, have reported that this model proved a superior model than the traditional method of teaching, and about net 10% of the studies have verified that there exists no significant difference in the achievement of students taught through flipped classroom model or by traditional model of teaching. So 90% studies have reported favor the flipped classroom model. So this is one study using the flipped classroom to enhance elementary foreign English as a foreign language learning, or examining flipped learning in sociology courses, a quasi experimental design, the flipped classroom and mind mapping in teaching basic sciences to postgraduate dental students, investigating the potential of the flipped classroom model in K-12 mathematics teaching and learning. Flipped classroom in organic chemistry has significantly effect on students' grades. Effects of a flipped classroom model in an introductory college mathematics course, or an action research study from implementing the flipped classroom model in primary school history teaching and learning. Impact of flipped teaching on student performance at school level in India in the context of different mediums of instruction. So an action research study. So friends, I'll suggest you one thing. What you can do, you can select 2-3 topics from your area of specialization, prepare the instruction material, or identify the videos already available on YouTube. So provide that material for those 3 topics to the students. In you see, you have say 40 students in the classroom. Firstly, you break down that 40 students classroom into 2 groups randomly. So one group will act as an experimental group, another group will act as a control group. So you have selected 3 topics, you have prepared a question paper, that is a test containing multiple choice question for those three topics. Now, to the one group, you will be employing the flipped classroom model, and to the other group, that is the control group, you will be teaching those topics by the conventional mode of teaching. So give administer the achievement test as a pretest, then give the conduct the experiment, and then at the end, after the 3 days, you will again administer the achievement test as post test. So pretest, post test, experimental control group design, so you can see whether your students obtain higher scores when they are exposed through flipped classroom than the students who were taught by mere chalk and talk. So you can do this small study and also write a paper and send the paper for publication. Now, goals of the classroom flip model. So find an approach that would make it possible for faculty to move from sage to guide. Reduce the amount of time spent in class on lecturing. So opening up class time for the use of active learning. You see strategies. Focus more on understanding and application than on recall of facts, while not sacrificing presentation of the factual base. Provide students with more control over their own learning. Give students a great sense of their responsibility for their learning and provide them more opportunity to learn from their peers. So flip flip model can be accomplished. You see, you can accomplish these goals by flipping what traditionally has been done inside and outside the classroom, deliver rote lecture content outline for students to study, and use the class time open up for learning based activities. So more lecture material out of classroom through online delivery, move homework into the classroom where the teacher can serve as a guide, use opened up time for discussion and practice, and extend conversation outside of the class through threaded discussion. Now, what are the steps or the rules involved for the implementation of the flipped instruction? You see, flipped classroom sounds tiring, and you might be thinking it is too much work. But friend, it has got huge advantages over traditional method of teaching, and we have already seen. So let us identify the key components necessary to make flipped model work. So there are 5 steps or rules of a flipped mastery classroom. Firstly, establish clear learning outcomes. Learning outcome is nothing but a sentence or statement which describes what the learner will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. So learning outcomes are the desired outcomes of learning for each student. So determine which of these learning outcomes are best achieved through inquiry and which are best learned through direct instruction. So you have to prepare learning material based upon the learning outcome, video, e-content, self-learning material, paperwork, and send to the student in the beginning. Then assure the access of video e-content to the student, that they all get the material. Maybe you can send through WhatsApp or email or Facebook. Then incorporate engaging learning activities to be done in the classroom. So students, they listen to instruction, interaction, discussion with peers, problem, question-based, experiential, debate, lab work in the class time. Then create multiple versions of each summative assessment for students, because there are various techniques of assessment. As I told you yesterday also, that each technique of assessment has its own advantages and disadvantages. So it will be incorrect to use only one technique of assessment for measuring students' varied learning ability. So provide a variety of assessment techniques while evaluating student performance through flipped model. Now, say the student motivation need is, I need to capture the interest of my students, and I want students to have greater sense of control over their own learning. So for this, the strategy would be provide a rich environment in which students can pursue their own interest and which can accommodate their different learning styles. And the content management system would be extensive online material in course content area, including resource material and links to online resources for students to follow if interested. Now coming to the self-learning material, because you have to provide e-content to your students before the class. So e-content should be in the form of self-learning material. It can be a printed PDF copy of self-learning material, or it could be a computer-based, so computer-assisted self-instructional material. So these are basically learner-centered material, and open, distance, and flexible learners usually depend a lot on self-learning material because they have to learn on their own at a time, pace, and place of their own choice. So self-learning material is a method of providing individualized instruction in which student is active and he or she proceeds at his or her own pace and is provided with immediate knowledge of result. So self-learning materials are basically based upon few important principles of psychology. Firstly, principle of small step. You see, students are provided input in small steps. Principle of active responding. Student remains active because he reads the material. The material is written on a conversational mode or interactive mode. When the student reads the material, he feels that the teacher is talking to him. There is no bookish language. The language is the student language in which they can understand. And principle of immediate knowledge of result is another psychological principle. So since there are inbuilt practice task questions, and then the students get feedback to those self-practice task questions. So the self-learning materials have got five important characteristics. First is self-explanatory. It means that the self-learning materials are developed in such a manner that doesn't require any intermediary like teacher to explain the content, because the material is to be studied by the student at home. So it should be written in a manner that should not require any intermediate to explain the content. So the content is written in simple and interactive language and in small chunks. I'll give you the illustration after the five characteristics are over. In small chunks to help the learners at home assimilate the content by reading and working through the instruction. So content is organized in logical and integrated manner. I can say that a teacher is built in into the text. Okay. So the material is explained with the help of examples, cases, illustrations. And in case it is CIE package, computer assisted, then we can integrate videos, animations, so that the learner can understand the content without any external support. In case he has got some doubts, he needs clarification, then he will go to the class next day because he has studied this one the previous night. So on the next day when he enters the classroom, he can ask for more information or for examples. Self-learning materials are self-contained. It means that the learners, you see, studying through self materials normally do not require additional material to learn. This is why, this is important. Why? Because the students, you see, they are at home. So since they are isolated and dispersed, they may not have access to good libraries and learning resources. So it is necessary that the learning materials supplied to them are detailed and self-contained in nature. Okay. So for example, if some course requires the student to listen to an audio cassette, then it should be supplied in the course pack to make it self-contained. So the material is self-sufficient to have a full comprehension of the subject matter. Then another is, self-learning materials are self-directed. As learners of self materials are dispersed and they study at home alone, so it is important to provide necessary direction, how to proceed, how to progress, how to study. So the materials are directed towards learner and help them fit into their own style of learning. Okay, so you can use variety of techniques, like use of hints, clues, notes, highlighting main points, use of graphics, or provide explicit directions on how to do, and what is expected of the learner. So these should be of self-direction mode. Self-motivating. As we all know that an important role of a teacher in the conventional mode of teaching is to inspire the learners toward the acquisition of concepts in the content. So as such, teachers act as role models while learners generally try to emulate them. Teachers in the classroom create students' interest and arouse their curiosity towards a subject. So this feature has to be included in self-learning material. So as such, self-learning material should create student interest, arouse their curiosity, and inspire them toward independent learning, critical thinking. So self-learning materials are designed to enhance the learner's acquisition by while learning, by relating the knowledge to familiar example, providing feedback at every stage of learning. You can provide interactive mode of presentation. You can include anecdotes. You can provide real life examples, illustrations. You can also have feedback on self-assessment questions. And self-learning materials are self-evaluating because they are students are studying at home. So as the learner studies the material independently and he wants to know how he or she is progressing in the study, particularly because the learner is not in direct contact with the teacher and he is at home. So in this type of learning situation, the learners may neither get timely feedback nor compare their performance. So the self-learning materials are self-learning practice not question followed by self-feedback. So now let me provide you an illustration of one very important how to develop one. So for you, I have taken a very simple topic. Of a computer assisted instruction package, uniform and non-uniform velocity. Now you see, there are number of tools available, softwares available, like toolbook, authorware, and number of software will be shared by Dr. K.G. Srinivasa today and tomorrow. Free softwares are available. But you see, I have developed this computer assisted instruction package on the PowerPoint itself. Now you see, in the PowerPoint, once you click the mouse anywhere on the screen, you get the next slide. Or you press any key of the keyboard, you get the next slide. Now in the PowerPoint presentation, we have got one facility that you can lock the mouse and the keyboard, and you have created the button like the start button. Once you click the start button here, you will get the next slide. Otherwise, by clicking here and there, you will not get the next slide. So I'm pressing. Okay. Now, so we'll start with. Now there are three buttons: home page, previous page, next page. Now, learning self-learning material will begin with a set of learning outcomes. As I told you in the beginning, a learning outcome is a sentence or statement which describes what the learner will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. So at the beginning, learning outcomes are stated, both general learning outcome and specific. So after the program or the session is over, you will be able to understand the concept of average speed, know uniform and non-uniform velocity, understand the concept of acceleration, and specific objectives are define average speed, calculate the average speed of a body, identify from the given example whether an object is accelerated, and state the SI units of acceleration. Now, next. Now you will have to test the prerequisites of your students, whether they possess something which you have already told in the previous lecture. So if your car is moving at a speed of 60 km per hour in first 2 hours and 72 km per hour for next 2 hours, it means your car is moving with, say, non-uniform speed. Let us say this is the answer. Now you get the feedback. I have taken this smiley from the Google. Well, your answer is correct. So it means you have got the feedback. Now the solution is also provided to the students. Now you can move to the next question. SI unit of velocity are, say answer is kilometer. Let us say your answer is not correct. So sad smiley. And you have got the feedback. Now you can move to the next question. Vector is a velocity is a vector quantity because it is determined by magnitude only, direction only, both magnitude and direction, neither magnitude nor direction. So let us say the answer is this one. So your answer is correct. Now the solution is given. For example, this man is walking with a velocity of 2 km per hour in west direction. Now proceed next. Now there is small input. Okay, this is a interactive language. Small input is given on one slide. On her way to Agra, Anjali travels by her car, which is moving at a speed of 50 km per hour for first hour and 60 km per hour for the next hour. Hello, Anji, I'm taking class. So what is the average speed of car? Well, average speed, you see, this is a question, or this is a kind of the language which the teacher normally uses in the classroom. This is a new term for you. You see, this is an interactive language. When you read as a learner, you will feel that a teacher is talking to you and not simply you are reading. This is not a bookish language. Now you will study about average speed. The question which comes in mind is that, is it necessary that an object covers equal distances in equal intervals of time? No, it is not possible. An object cannot cover equal distance in equal intervals of time. For example, while traveling in a car, it is not possible to keep car at a constant speed. So it is better to expect speed in terms of average speed. You see, now in this first slide, some input is given. The student can study at his own pace. In a normal classroom, teaching, the teacher delivers the instruction at a very high rate of high rate, and slow learners cannot meet the pace at which the teacher is talking to them. So he can read again and again. Now he can move to the previous page or he can move to the next page. Next. So when we travel, in a vehicle, the speed of the vehicle changes from time to time depending on the conditions existing on the road. So in such a situation, the speed is calculated by the ratio of the total distance traveled by the vehicle to the total time taken for the journey. This is called as average speed. Now here I have used different font color to gain the attention of the students. I have taken one illustration. This illustration animation has been taken from Google. Or you have also used the different font size. Now next page. Let us move to next. If an object covers a distance s1 in time t1, distance s2 in time t2, and distance sn in time tn, then the average speed is given by, you see, I have written the general formula in a box so to gain the attention. So average speed. So thus, when we say that the car travels at an average speed of 60 km per hour, it doesn't mean that the car would be moving with the speed of 60 km throughout the journey. Now next. After this small input, there is one question. This is self practice. Okay. So he will find out the average speed with the use of formula. So for the formula, he can again go back to the previous slide. He can see. So say the answer is 44.4 km per hour. So you get the smiley. Okay. So your answer is correct. Okay. And the calculation is also given. Now next. Now small input. You can take an example of a car. This illustration has been taken from Google. As in the case of uniform speed, car will have uniform velocity if it covers equal distances in equal intervals of time, no matter how small these time intervals may be, but in a specified direction in a single line. So in this example, car will be having So in this example, car will be having uniform velocity only if it travels 30 km per hour in the same direction. Now next. But what will happen if car changes its direction? Yes, change in direction will lead to change in the velocity of the car. So velocity of the car will not remain uniform as in case of travel. So let us think. You see, this is attention gaining device. I have put two stars. These are two ways, either change the speed of the body or change the direction of the body by keeping speed at constant. Now you can move to the next. So now you can take an example. Two athletes, Ram and Shyam, you see, are running with a uniform speed of 5 m/s. Ram is running on a straight track. So in the classroom, you cannot show this illustration. I have taken it from the Google. Now next. Shyam moves in a circle track. Now this has been beautifully shown. For a layman, both Ram and Shyam are moving with uniform velocity, but for a physicist only, of course, Ram is running with a uniform velocity because there is no change in his speed and direction of motion. Whereas in the case of Shyam, who is running along a circular track, the direction of motion is changing at every instant as circle is polygon with infinite sides, and Shyam has to change his direction at every instant. Next. So you now can define these terms. So I have put these in a rectangular box. So this is the definition. Next. So different font color, font size, small material, small chunk. Let us take one more example. So car is moving, you see, on a road. What about its velocity? Okay. Will it be uniform or not? So answer to the problem is velocity of a car is not uniform. You see, when a teacher is teaching in the class, he cannot make the things, you can say, very simple to all types of students. But in this case, every student can read or study at his or her own pace. And this is to be provided before coming to the classroom. So they will study at home. Okay, so when they come to the classroom, so the teacher has prepared a structured set of you can say questions. So he will give to the students. They will they do the problem solving in the classroom. Now next, there is another question now. Okay, a bus is moving on a hilly road with speed of 20 km per hour. It means the bus is moving with say uniform velocity. Your answer is not correct, because bus is moving with constant speed, but it has to change its direction on a hilly road again and again. So bus is moving with non-uniform velocity. Okay, next. The problem has given rise to the new concept in the field of motion, and that is acceleration. So this is small illustration is given. Again, this has been taken from Google. I have not I have simply compiled them, and I have developed in an interactive language the questions, the feedback, these I have introduced. Now next, in the above example, car changes its velocity after every 5 seconds. So again, the formulas are given here. Now you can try to answer this. What will be the acceleration of the body if it doesn't change its velocity with time? So small computation is given here. So now you have highlighted here. Now try to find the answer. The answer is 5 m/s². So your answer is not correct. Now the solution is given here. So answer is 2 m/s². Now next. Well, the term acceleration need not always mean that the velocity of a moving body is always increasing. It can also decrease, remain the same. So you can take one more example. Now I have put one more example. This is the example. Train starts from rest. Again, I have taken it from Google. That it accelerates. After some time, it continues moving with uniform velocity of 100 m/s, that is A0. As it approaches another station, velocity starts decreasing and finally it comes to rest. So here velocity and acceleration of train change as it starts from station A and reaches station B. Now magnitude and direction of acceleration changes with changing velocity of a body. Here you can see length of arrow changing with changing velocity and acceleration. Again, this has been taken from, so this is a rule of thumb. When an object is slowing down, the direction of the acceleration is in this one. Now, end of the session test. Now, after the whole module is over, now you will have 2-3 questions pertaining to the entire chapter. So average speed is equal to, say, answer is this, speed divided by total time. Your answer is not correct. It is total distance traveled by total time taken. Next, a body moving with a constant speed of 20 m/s and following a zigzag path has non-uniform velocity. Your answer is correct. The SI unit of acceleration is say m/s². Again, you get the feedback. Okay, smiley. So at the end, the session can be summarized under following points. So again, the summary has been given. So or you can go to previous page, or you can go to the home page. See, you have gone to home page. So friends, I think you can develop self-learning material, which can be uploaded on the website of the institute. Students can download, they can self-study at home, and as in case of flipped classroom model, the actual problem solving will be carried out in the classroom with teacher more contact time with the students. And even in case of normal classroom teaching or for blended learning, you can also develop these e-content and CI packages and upload on the institute for supplementing. And these are very important for those who could not attend attend one session or the other session because of one reason or the other reason. So friends, thank you very much. Now the session is over, and if you have any question or any query, you are welcome. You have asked, can SLM sometimes also pave way for misconception which imposes the risk of unlearning? You see, no misconception, because you have developed the CI package, you will also share with your friend or your colleague. Okay, ask for any feedback. So on obtaining feedback, you will finalize it. Then there is no chance that the student find it you can say difficult.
Any question, you can either write it in the chat box or you can just ask question also, one or two questions, because we don't have much of time.
So you see, copying the images from Google will not count for copyright infringement if you are using it for teaching learning process only, not for commercial use. So you can, you see, make the theoretical lecture very interactive by use of interactive language, by use of some you can say illustrations, by drawing some concept map. I have given you an idea of concept map yesterday in my lecture. You can make it very much interesting. You can explain derivation mathematical portion on online teaching by the use of self-learning material.
Hello.
For the
classroom,
you can use the YouTube videos. You can provide YouTube video links to the student. They can study at home, and when they come to the classroom, they can ask for clarification. Or even you can ask them to watch the video during the classroom, because in today's age, everybody is allowed to carry mobile phone in the classroom. Earlier, the mobile phones were used to be banned in the classroom. Now it is allowed. Now, what if if students did not study at home, then they will not be able to solve the numericals in the classroom. So they have to, they have to study. You have to encourage them to study at home, because you are not giving the abstract notes to the students. That is why I'm telling you, you have to develop e-content. And that is why Dr. K.G. Srinivasa has included one or two sessions on developing e-content, as well as he is also sharing with you open source softwares for the development of the content. So my email ID is
thank you very much, sir. Very interactive and very nice presentation, and definitely this will be of real help to the teachers who wants to implement blended classroom, and a very informative session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
very much.
See you back at 12 o'clock on the same link.
Sir, any attendance sheet?
We will share the video presentation.
Hello?
Any madam? Attendance sheet for the morning session, sir?
Madam, they will send. They have already sent it. Sir. Don't worry. In the afternoon, sir, also, they will share.
For the morning session, I will be sending it in this particular session. The session will be sent.
Okay. For the morning session, we will get it at 12 o'clock session. Don't
okay. Worry. Sir, do we have any assignments to be done?
No, madam. Everything, there will be one quiz on the last day. That is on Friday.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay, because previous program when I attended, we had assignments to do. That's why I'm asking. Okay, thank you.
No. You don't want to stress people sir, too much.
Excuse me, sir.
Good morning.
Ah.
Hello.
Can you share the reference materials, sir?
Madam, materials, if the people provide you, we will give you. We cannot compel the people to give you. Anyway, we will share you the recordings. Okay?
Okay, sir. Because net connectivity is poor, we are unable to...
We will share you the link of the recordings that we have done. Okay?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.